Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Kemet's presentation titled Power Switch Selection as part of Kemet's Design It Day. My name is David Adib, and I am Kemet's Senior Technical Marketing Engineer here in Florida. Our presenter today is Didier Balocco, and he works for ON Semiconductor as a technical marketing engineer. With that said, I will turn it over to Didier to give us some more background about himself and begin his presentation for today. Didier, please go ahead.
Thank you, David, for the introduction. Good morning or good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining the session. So the session is called High Voltage Power Switch Selection Guidance. I will try to give you some key and element to select high voltage switches in your application. So I'm Didier Balocco. I have an engineer diploma from the École Nationale Supérieure d'Électronique et de Radioélectricité de Bordeaux in France in 92. And after that, I have made a PhD in the University of Bordeaux. It was not about wine, but about PFC. My experience is I've worked as a research engineer for DC-DC, AC-DC, and DC-AC converter for telecom, solar, and many domain of application in a range of 1 watt to 150 kilowatt from 96 to 2014. After that, I joined Fairchild Semiconductor as a FAE to support France, Spain, and Portugal. And with the merge between Fairchild Semiconductor and ON Semiconductor, I take the opportunity to become technical marketing engineer for Europe. So regarding the content, it will be straightforward. I will make a brief introduction of ON Semiconductor. I will discuss the perfect switch that do not exist. And then we'll cover the real switches like diode with silicon and silicon carbide diode, transistor or switch with IGBT, super junction, super silicon carbide switches and gallium nitride switches. We'll talk about the association between driver and the switch to see what combination we can make. And at the end, I will just introduce our physical and scalable simulation model that are definitely here to help you to use those components. So brief introduction of ON Semiconductor. ON Semiconductor is a worldwide company with a focus and a vision on power, analog, sensor, connectivity solution, and to enable an efficient electronic world or solution. Our focus is mainly in automotive, industrial, cloud, and IoT with all the structure to support quality, supply chain, and so on. So today ON Semiconductor is around 5.5 billion. And we have five major sector of sales: automotive, industrial and medical and defense, communication, consumer, and computer. So regarding the solution for automotive, and EV is part of this market, we provide intelligent light sensor, intelligent driving with power management, and also a lot of module for the 48 vehicle or the hybrid vehicle. For industrial and cloud, we have a leadership in discrete and module portfolio for industrial. We have a smart power solution for data centers to give a very efficient solution also with MOSFET for 5G infrastructure and high efficiency wide band gap. For Internet of Things, we have a very low power intelligent sensor and connectivity and power management. We have a leadership on vision and audio solution and end-to-end connectivity with Bluetooth low power, BLE, and software to support those applications. So Onsemi has shipped a lot of power component in solar to create a lot of solar plant, and those solar plant actually will replace around 130 coal-fired plant. So going back to the topic, the perfect power switch, it's very simple. It's a switch with zero leakage during off state, zero voltage drop during on state, and zero switching losses when we switch between on and off or off and on. So the first switch that we have is the diode. So we have several kinds of diode depending on the compromise you want to make between switching losses and conduction losses. Ultra fast are more for low frequency with a high reverse recovery or compromised reverse recovery. Medium frequency, we have hyper fast diode and with a soft recovery. And for high frequency, we have the stealth, stealth one and stealth two, with very good EMI performances due to the very soft recovery. And now comes a new player, that is the silicon carbide diode with very low conduction losses and very low switching losses because there's almost no reverse recovery effect on silicon carbide. Regarding positioning in terms of switching frequency, you can see that mainly the major point is the reverse recovery that you can see on the right of the slide. And you can see that depending on the technology, as far as you go higher and higher in switching frequency, the reverse recovery effect diminutes. And if we compare now with the silicon carbide diode, you see that the reverse recovery is almost nothing. In fact, it's not a reverse recovery. It's just a capacitive effect that you see the discharge of this parallel capacitor. So regarding our diode portfolio on 600 volts below 20 amp, we have a huge portfolio. In green, you see the silicon carbide diode, and in black, the regular silicon diode. We cover almost all type of package and all current rating. The same with the range from 30 to 80 amp. Here it's mainly through all package, and you see that our silicon carbide diode are up to 50 amp, while in regular silicon, we can go up to 80 amps. 1200 volt space, the same. We have a diode in silicon carbide from 5 amp to 50 amp, and silicon diode up to 75 amp. And here you find a full all package and also SMD package with D-pack and D-square pack diodes. Regarding the transistor, we have different transistor, IGBT, superjunction, silicon carbide, and GaN, gallium nitride. So if we compare the material, we see that the GaN is the best in terms of electric field, have a good energy gap, and a good electron mobility, but not so much a good thermal conductivity. Good thermal conductivity is for silicon carbide with that will allow a higher temperature operation if we have the high temperature packaging. But regarding GaN, we have to mitigate that because actually most of the GaN are lateral device, and this parameters I shown here is more for a vertical device. So regarding the three type of structure we have for switches, we have a bipolar transistor, isolated gate bipolar transistor, and metal oxide field effect transistor. So bipolar actually are less and less use just in some specific high frequency case. And we are using in power mainly MOSFET and IGBT, IGBT up to 100 kilohertz and MOSFET up to 1 megahertz. Advantages of the MOSFET is that it has a very fast switching, a very simple drive with a voltage drive, the same as an IGBT. The drawback of IGBT is that the SOA is a little bit lower and there's more switching losses, reducing the switching speed of the IGBT. If we look at power versus frequency or switching frequency, this is a view of where stand the IGBT, the silicon carbide MOSFET, and the superjunction FET. You see, superjunction is for the lower power compared to silicon carbide, higher power, and IGBT stand in the low frequency range. And now if I add the GaN, GaN is for the low power and in high frequency operation, allowing much higher higher switching frequency than silicon carbide. If I look how to select a switch, if it is an IGBT, a MOSFET, or a silicon carbide MOSFET, it will depend either on the operating condition. For example, the switching frequency is listed above, or the power rating. You can select the switch, or it can be based on the application. For example, if you're doing a motor drive, you will preferably use an IGBT. In UPS and welding, they are widely used. While if you go for EV car charger or onboard charger, they will prefer a silicon carbide MOSFET to go high frequency and high power to reduce the size of the charger embedded in the car. So regarding the IGBT, how to select the IGBT, this is just some basic graph or topology on topology that are widely used depending on the application and the type of IGBT we can use. We have two or three generation of IGBT, and depending on the location of the IGBT, one technology is better than the other one. And this is what you can see on this slide. So we have a complete portfolio of IGBT for 650 volts from 40 to 75 amp, mainly in TO247 or D square pack. We sell also die, and on the left, on the right of the presentation, you see the application. For the 1200 volt, we have almost the same range, except we start at 25 amp up to 75 amp. Our new generation is our ultra field stop trench technology. And we have here only four all packages. Superjunction FET. We have three kinds of superjunction FET: the fast version, the easy drive version, and the fast recovery version. As the name says, the fast version is only for high speed switching and hard switching with a very low switching losses. Easy drive version is a compromise between switching performances and EMI, and making the superjunction FET easier to drive because we have integrated part of the gate resistor internally. And this is a non-linear resistor that will allow a very high current at the beginning when we turn on the IGBT and reduce the current while we get to the maximum current to avoid any overshoot. The fast recovery or the FR FET are a special technology dedicated to soft switching where during such switching, we use the diode of the MOSFET, and this diode has a special treatment to have lower QR and TRR, French accent, and make the diode more robust to withstand the full current and for a long time. So now if I'm looking which application and which technology of superjunction We want to use, you see that depending on the application, if you want to make a PFC, you will use the fast switching version, or if you want efficiency, if you are using an LLC or phase shifted full bridge, you will use the fast reverse, the fast recovery FET. Or if you want to play a compromise between the performances and the easy implementation of your circuit, you will use the easy version of the super FET. Regarding our portfolio, as you can see here, we cover with the different generation from 1 ohm down to 25 ohm, either in easy drive, fast recovery, or fast switching. The fast switching, even with SuperFET 3, we go below the 25 milliohm. In easy drive, we have also an 800 volt version for a single switch flyback. Regarding silicon carbide portfolio in MOSFET, we have samples and almost release all the 1200 volt SiC MOSFET in the range of 20 milliohm to 160 milliohm. They are all available as DI, TO247 or D2PAC7 lead, in order to reduce the switching losses. I will describe that later. Regarding 900 volt silicon MOSFET, mainly dedicated for EV charging, because they are using 800 volt batteries, so they are fitting quite well for this voltage space. We have released the 60 and the 20 milliohm, and we will release soon, before the end of the year, the 30, 80, and 160 milliohm in TO247 and D2PAC7 lead, and also as DI. We have currently our new 650 volt SiC MOSFET generation, covering a range from 15 to 120 milliohm. We have currently sample of the 15 and 50 milliohm, and the other value will be available mainly next year. What I can say is that all our silicon carbide device, diode and MOSFET, are automotive qualified, or will be automotive qualified. So regarding the association between driver, the switch, and the package, let's take an example. I want to drive a switch. I take a 3-pin package, let's say a TO247 or a D2PAC. I take a driver, a regular one. I take a resistor to connect to the gate, and I make the connection. And when I make the connection between the driver, the resistor, and the switch, I have a leakage inductance on the return path. If now I turn on the switch, I have a current that starts to flow from the positive rail of the power supply of the driver through the resistor to the gate of the switch, trying to turn on the switch. As the switch turns on, I have a current flowing from the that I have represented in green here, and this current goes through this parasitic inductor, creating a voltage drop. I have symbolized here by V, that is proportional to the LDIDT, and this voltage drop reduces the amount of current applied to the gate to charge the gate and make the turn on slower. And as the time passes, my driver starts to heat up, and if the driver heats, it reduces the amount of current that flow to the gate, taking more time to turn on the device. So at the end, you have a high current and a slow turn on, because you have losses inside the driver and the effect of the leakage inductance. Now, if I Oui, I changed my beginning. I just changed my switch to use a 4-pin package like the Teoto 47 4 lead or the D-Square Pack 7 lead or the Teo leadless package. And I changed for the new NCD 57 series from Monsumai. That is a new driver with a higher current capability and also lower internal resistance for the driver output stage MOSFET. I select the same resistor. I connect the driver to the Kelvin pin of the switch, and I still connect the switch to the power line, but I do not connect the 2-0 between the driver and the switch and the rest of the application. And now when I turn on with my high current available with my new driver, as my zero are disconnected, when my power start to flow, the effect of the parasitic inductance or the leakage inductance of the layout is not affecting the voltage applied to the gate. So I have also a smaller heat inside the package because my MOSFET have a stronger current capability and also a lower internal resistance. So at the end, my current decreases less and I can continue to drive fast and turn on fast my switch. So this is our new NCD 57 series. This is the full features driver with the magnetic isolation in between. And we have a complete range of driver with 8-pin, 60-pin, wide body, narrow body package, and so on. So this is the selection guide of those driver, and you can see depending on the package and the function you want, you can select a different version and it can be applied to many applications. So now if you remember this slide about the type of IGBT you want to use, depending on the topology, I have added on the bottom of the slide the type of gate driver you need, depending if it's a low side or a half voltage or isolated driver that you need for this application. So now going to simulation, and we have introduced a new way of creating a model that we call physical and scalable modeling. And I will explain you the difference of this modeling and how perform this modeling technique. So our modeling technique is based on one thing, is based on physics and dimension of the die. We really include inside our model all the information regarding the chip or the die layout and the process parameter, like the doping, like the length of the pulley gate, the depth of the GFET, and so on. All those parameters are included in our model and are used by new physical equation included inside the model. So if I look at how perform this model, you can see on the graph in the middle top that you have a linear and log scale, linear scale on the left and log scale on the right for the same current. This is the gain of the MOSFET. You see that the gain is accurate in a range from 1 to 1 power minus 4. You can see also effect like on the left top graph, the effect of the self-thermal heating of the device, flattening the curve. We have also a real diode, a diode with VF that decreases with temperature, is what you can see on the top right graph. the same with the leakage current that reduces as the temperature increases. And you can see that on the bottom left graph. But also with those simulation model, you can create graph like RDS-on as a function of the temperature that is not always available in the datasheet, or the threshold voltage variation depending on temperature. And you can produce any curve you want that is in the datasheet or not in the datasheet. But those models are not intended only to give you parameters that are not available in the datasheet. They are also made to help you to design the full application. And here we have just modeled our double pulse tester in our lab and run our model in time domain. And you can see that we have a really good prediction. For example, during on time, we can predict the overcurrent due to the turn on and the charging and the turn on of the MOSFET. Or we can predict the over voltage also at turn off. And you see that we are predicting quite accurately the over voltage spike. We cannot predict the high frequency ringing, mainly because I think we don't have no parasitic inductor due to the layout here in that simulation schematic. But I'm sure if we include those, we will be able to predict the high frequency ringing that you can see on the on curve, for example. So that was all for today. Thank you for listening. And I hope you have a more comprehensive knowledge about the high voltage switches.
Thank you very much, Didier. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your attention. Have a nice day. See you next time, and goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.